I ask you would look with me in your Bibles as we see the Gospel of St. Matthew, the 25th chapter, verses 14 through 30. This is a very powerful message in which Christ leaves to his disciples. In the Gospel according to St. Matthew, we find out it talks about how Jesus gives three persons a talent, a gift. He gives one man five, another one two, and another one one. We will find out this is a message about being faithful over whatever God has given to you. Now, all of us, we've been blessed by God. We've been given certain gifts, talents, and capabilities. But you know what? God gives them to us for a purpose, and that is to steward over them, to be faithful over what God has given to us. I hope by the conclusion of this message, you can ask yourself the question, am I being faithful over what God has given to me? Listen to what it says. It says, "For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country, who called his own servants and delivered unto him his goods. And unto one he gave five talents, and to another two, and to another one, to every man according to his several ability, and straightway took his journey. Then he that had received the five talents, he traded with them the same and made five other talents. And likewise he that had received two, he also gained other two. But he that received one and digged in the earth and hid his Lord's money. And after a long time, the Lord of the servants came, reckoning with them. Also he that had received five talents came and brought the other five, saying, Lord, thou hast delivered unto me five talents. Behold, I have gained five talents more. The Lord said unto him, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter thou unto the joy of our Lord. He also that had received the two talents came to the Lord and said, Lord, thou hast delivered unto me two talents, and behold, I have gained two more talents. His Lord said unto him, well done, good and faithful servant. Thou been faithful over a few things. I have made thee ruler over many. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord. Then he that had received the one talent came to the Lord and said, Lord, I know that thou art a hard man, reaping where thou hast not sown, and gathering where thou hast not strawed. And I was afraid, so I went and hid thy talent in the earth. And lo, this is what I have to present back to you. His Lord answered and said unto him, thou wicked and slothful servant, thou knowest I reap where I sowed not, and gather where I have not strawed. Thou art therefore have put my money to the exchangers. Then at my coming, I should have received mine own with usury. Therefore, take the talent from him and give it to the one who hath 10 talents. And unto every one that hath shall be given, and he that hath abundance. But from him that hath not shall be taken away, even that which he hath. And he cast the unprofitable servant into outer darkness, and there was weeping and gnashing of teeth." I want to ask you a question as I ask myself the question, am I faithful over these few things? You know, we live in a world today that sometimes we forget that God calls us, first of all, to be faithful. Now, our faithfulness has to be first and foremost with our relationship with Almighty God. The Bible teaches us that God wants us to have a faithful relationship with Him. We can glean some insights as we look into the Old Testament. The Old Testament tells us that Jesus, as he is presenting himself through the words of the Father and with the expression of the Holy Spirit, he meets Moses and he gives Moses what is known as the 10 Commandments. And the 10 Commandments, you'll find out, of those 10 Commandments, 4 of them deal with our relationship with God, but the other 6 deal with our relationship with one another. I think it's so amazing how God always reminds us to get our relationship right with him first, and then we can work at our relationships with our brothers and our sisters. I want to ask you the question as I ask myself the question, am I being faithful over what God has given to me? In the parable that I've just read out of Matthew's Gospel, the 25th chapter, it talks about how God, through this parable, gives every last one of us a gift according to our ability. I'm so happy that we all have different abilities, we have different talents, we have different skills, and God gives all of us just what we need based upon He knows what our capacity is. I'm so happy that God doesn't give us all the very same thing, and if He did, the world would be so different. It would all be just like we are all clones one of the other. But God does something so powerful. He understands and He knows that I can only handle what He wants me to handle. You can only handle what God gives you to handle. And so He gives us just what He knows we can deal with. So in the parable, we see that the man who had five talents, he took them and he invested them because he knew the Lord would be gone for a period of time. You and I both know that the Bible teaches us something, as we find out in life, how we can gain interest over things that we commit to people who can take good care of them. This parable talks about a man who had five talents. He was smart enough to understand that if I put these talents to work, I can double what God has given to me. Many times you and I forget that God wants to double all of our efforts by putting those into His hands. When we put our lives and all that God has given us into His hands, we can find out it will be double and we'll have more than what we ever started out with. The second man in the text, he's been given two talents, and notice what he does. He takes the two talents, he multiplies them, and he gains two more. He has double of what he had. And God does the very same thing with him. He tells him, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant." I have to ask myself the question, as you have to ask yourself the question, how faithful are we with what God has given to us? God has given us time, God has given us talent, and God has given us treasures. And we have to be faithful in each one of those aspects of our life. When we talk about time, you know, God has given us so much time. Somebody once said, if we could take the time that we use watching TV, watching the basketball game, watching the football game, when it's snowing outside, all we're doing sometimes is just sitting in front of a TV. If we could take that same energy, that same amount of effort, and invest it in a degree, just think how many of us can have PhDs as we're sitting here today, or while you're sitting there in your home. Many times we forget that God wants us to invest our time in what He has given us to do. Many times when we can talk about investment and getting return, we look at things that we can materialistically touch. We look at houses, we look at dollars. But I want to ask you the question, as I ask myself the question, how much are we investing in our relationships? Now, in the Ten Commandments, we find out that the first four deal with our relationship with God. It tells us how important that we should have no other gods before us. I want to ask you and ask myself the question, how many times do we allow ourselves to make gods of these things that we experience throughout life? Somebody once said, it seems as though on Sunday afternoons and now Mondays and Thursdays that we can be worshiping the God of the pigskin. That is, many times you and I spend so much time watching football on TV, giving all of our time to TV. Do we give God a commensurate amount of time? Wouldn't it be wonderful if we invested in the relationship that God would have us to have with Him? The Bible tells us in those Ten Commandments, the first four, talks about our relationship with God. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Then after it talks about not having any other gods before us, it reminds us that God wants us to make sure that we don't make any graven images, to create things that seem like they're an idol, something that we worship. How many times have you and I bought a car? When we buy a car, some of us, we're parking not only in our spot, but half of the other spot next to us because we don't want any scratches on it. Do we do that with our spirituality? Do we want to make sure that we don't have any scratches or dings in our relationship with God? You know, when we start to focus our energy and our time and our effort about building the relationship with God and making sure we have our relationship as it should be, God is first, and we have no graven images, and then we can find ourselves moving in a wonderful relationship and what God has called us to do. God has called us to have fellowship with Him. And the only way that we can make sure this fellowship is as it should be is by giving God what He asks for us most of all, and that is our interest and what He would love for us to do. You know, God gives all of us something to do, and if God gives me something to do, I should give my undivided attention to what God has given to me. Too oftentimes we forget when God gives us these great materialistic things in our society, we put so much focus and so much emphasis on it that we forget that this is only the iceberg of what God would have us to do. When I begin to examine these Ten Commandments, it talks about our relationship with God. And then it talks about the relationship we should have with one another. When you and I look at the latter of the six commandments, it talks about having an investment in our family and our brothers and sisters. Too oftentimes, we forget that God created us for the purpose of having fellowship with Him and fellowship with one another. Can He say to you and to me, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant"? Have we been faithful in our relationships as it relates to our home and our domestic life? How many times do you and I steal from the time that we have with our family and we give it to our place of employment? So oftentimes we spend so much time doing our jobs that we forget about our primary job that God has given us, being faithful stewards over the relationship with our family. Be it your husband, be it your wife, be it your child, be it your sibling, we must invest in our family and building the relationships that will sustain us throughout the test of time. Now, on a day like today in Raleigh, North Carolina, many people are at home because there's so much snow and ice, they cannot venture out. The roads have not been cleared. And so we all are in our houses together with one another. Are we investing that time in building those relationships? I can remember growing up as a child when we had storms. It was time when we were doing nothing more than talking with one another. It was before we had all of these digital and electronic games. It was before we had this virtual reality. It was before we had so many TV channels, and all of us now have our own personal data device. It was the time that we had to spend time sharing with one another, or even more so, investing in a relationship. Somebody said, whenever you're spending time with somebody, you'll never get back what you spent. But if you're making an investment, you're going to have a return. This parable reminds me that you and I can have a return on the investment of relationships if we would put in relationships the same kind of energy we put in our material wealth and growth. Wouldn't it be awesome if we would say, God, I love you so much. I want to hear from you. What will you have me to do? The Bible tells us, even in the book of Micah and the Old Testament in the 6th chapter, what does the Lord require of you but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God? Now, you know, I think that has a whole lot to do with relationships, because when you and I invest the right kind of time in relationships, we have the right kind of returns. I don't know about you, but one of the things that I found out from looking at my biological family, my mother and my father showed me something that was so important. They took care of their parents as their parents got older. And for that reason, my siblings, and I have noticed not only in my siblings, but my other cousins, we take care of our parents because we saw modeled in front of us the behavior that creates wonderful families that can be fused together even in their diversity. God has given us a wonderful opportunity in our society. We have diversified families all over. Our families are not always the way they once have been. Our families become an amalgamation of so many other persons that we can call family. Many of us in our current environments, we are not geographically close to our biological family. And so the people that we worship with, the people that we engage in activities with, become our family, and we invest in the relationship. And we learn this from the very foundational principles that God has given to us. There's a whole lot buzzing in the air about what does it mean to be family. And I think Jesus told us like nobody else. The Bible says that when Jesus was ministering, someone came to him and said, Jesus, your mother and your brother and your family, they're outside. And Jesus says, whoever does the will of my Father, that's my family. Can God say well done to us? Are we doing a great job of raising our children, putting before them the principles of the Bible, letting them know what God has said in His Word? How God wants us to have a relationship with Him, that we can have relationships with one another to be the sign of the cross. So I don't know about you, but when I get to the crossroads of my life, I have to ask myself the question, is my relationship right with God, and is it right with those around us? When we can look at this parable and invest our time and our energy and our efforts into those who are part of our biological family and our spiritual family, we can make this world a better place. I don't know about you, but I'm looking for a better place. This year of 2017 has to be better than what we've seen in the past. When I begin to think about how God is moving like never before, in North Carolina, we found out because of all the snow, we could not have the inaugural ceremony of the governor. But that doesn't mean the work cannot continue. Sometimes we allow temporary interruptions to keep us from doing the business at hand. The governor is now not so much having a ball, but he has prepared emergency management that we can deal with the environment that we're in. Wouldn't it be awesome if all of our families, we had an emergency management room? A place where we can get together and say, we need to take care of family so God can say, well done, that we are now praying like never before. We are now reading God's word like never before. We're showing each other love and compassion like never before. I don't know about you, but I want to hear him say, well done when I stand before him. Well done in your time, well done in your treasure, and well done in your investment. I asked you today, how much are you investing in your relationship with God, your relationship with those around us? And when we make this investment, I believe we'll get a return like never before. Whenever you make an investment, whoever your portfolio, your advisor is, they will tell you about everything that's in the fund. And you know, I like to play with that. It's a fund, F-U-N-D, but you can have a whole lot of F-U-N as you put it in the F-U-N-D. When we put fun back into our families, enjoying the presence of one another. I don't know about you, but I enjoy being around family because family is where you can be who and what God has called you to be. When we go back to the parable, it says that each one of the persons were given gifts according to talents, according to their several ability. I want to ask you, are you using what God has given to you? Are you using your gift for the glory of God? The Bible reminds us, seek first the kingdom of God and all of his righteousness, and all the other things that be added unto you. I don't know about you, but I want to make sure the things that are added unto me, that I can count my blessings and name them one by one. Jesus says, well done, because he started counting what those persons brought to him. I want to ask you, can your family count on you? Can your congregation count on you? Can your neighborhood count on you to make it a better place? I'm so happy of the hymnologist who said, count your many blessings and name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. So today, count your blessings as we spend this time of reflection, this time of introspection, asking ourselves, are we faithful over what God has given to us? Be faithful over what God has given to you. Count your blessings. Name them one by one. It will surprise you what the Lord has done. Then after you count, allow your young people to count it with you. Allow your family members to count God's blessings. Allow your family members at church to count all of your blessings and see what God has done. Today, I'm counting it a blessing that I have the opportunity to stand before you through and by the wonderful medium of what God has given us called technology. Jesus says, greater works than these shall you also do because I've gone to the Father. And because Jesus has gone to the Father, he has given us this technological age that we can share the gospel, the good news, and to show people God is alive and real in our lives. So let's use these moments, these days, these hours, these times, this Sunday, while you're there with your family, while you're all over the world watching this message, and count your blessings and say, God, thank you for what you've done in my life and the life of my family. I want to pray with you as we bring this message to a close. Let us go to God in prayer. God, we thank you so very much for this day. We thank you for the blessings you've given to us. God, today as we pray, we say thank you for our family, for our friends. Thank you for sending to us your Son, Jesus the Christ, to be our expression of life. God, we thank you. We've just come out of the Advent season. We've gone into Christmas, and now we're beginning a new year. And we thank you for the opportunity to use the talents, the gifts, the capabilities you've put into our hands. Help us to be like the stewards in the text, who received five and brought back five more, who received two and brought back two more. But God, never let us be like the one who buried what you gave to them. Father, help us never to bury our talents, bury the gifts you've given to us, but help us to dig deep down within and find the love that you've given to us, that we might share your love with the world. And God, we'll be ever grateful. We'll give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. And we'll thank you for the powerful work of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. We pray God will bless you and that you'll have a wonderful week as you ask yourself the question, have I been faithful over these few things that God has given to me? Use what little you have and it will become so much. Danny Bell Hall put it this way, little becomes much when you place it in the Master's hand. Whatever you have, give it to God and allow God to place it back in your hand. When our hands are in His hands, we will accomplish what He's called us to do. Be faithful over these little things, and He'll give us leadership and influence over so many. God bless you, heaven smile upon you, and may the peace of God be with you until we meet again. God bless you and amen.